नमस्कार, न्यूज क्लिक में आपका स्वागत है। आज हमारे खास मेहमान हैं जो एक वकील हैं, अनस तनवीर। अनस तनवीर इज द फाउंडर ऑफ द ICLU, इंडियन सिविल लिबर्टीज यूनियन। इनका एक परिचय ये है कि अनस जी ने काफ़ी समय से NRC और सिटीजनशिप अमेंडमेंट बिल में इन्वॉल्व रहे हैं। अनस, आपका स्वागत है। ज़रा सा बताइए कि असम में जब NRC का प्रोसेस चला था, तब ICLU उसमें इन्वॉल्व था, आपकी क्या रूपरेखा थी उसमें?
ICLU got involved after the list was published in real sense.
मतलब final list आने के
बाद? When the final list was published, we realized from the social media and other places that there is lot of panic on ground. And panic never helps anyone.
Right.
So, in order to just allay some fears, just to tell people that they're in safe hands, that nothing is lost, you are not a foreigner already, you still have a chance to go for an appeal. To explain to them that procedure, we shared a helpline with another organization called United Against Hate. They have a helpline called Helpline Against Hate. So we shared that helpline with them. And we, first of all, through speaking to them or asking them for their documents and telling them there's no issue with your document, everything is all right, telling them what exactly is wrong and what went wrong and how it can be remedied, what grounds can be taken in appeal. So we started with working on those things, and gradually we also moved on ground. We set up legal aid camps in districts of Udarang, Udalguri in Assam. And in doing so, we became, from what I know, one of the first organizations, civil liberty organization, to be on ground after the list was published. We catered to close to 300 to 500 people in a single day. And accompanying us were students of National Law University Assam, who were a day before our visit were given paralegal training by me and my members of my organization.
तो मतलब कि जैसे सिविल सोसाइटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस वहाँ जाती हैं, अवेयरनेस फैलाने की कोशिश करती हैं और सरकार का विरोध भी करती हैं अगर कुछ गलत हो रहा हो, तो आपका ग्रुप कैसे अलग है?
हम सरकार का विरोध नहीं करते हैं, हम एक्टिविस्ट नहीं हैं, हम प्योर वकील हैं। वी आर सिंपली एडवोकेट्स, वी डोंट गेट ऑन ग्राउंड्स, वी डोंट प्रोटेस्ट। इफ वी सी अ प्रॉब्लम, वी ऑलवेज नो, एंड वन मस्ट ऑलवेज नो दैट देयर विल बी अ लीगल सोल्यूशन टू दैट। माय whole mandate is that that legal solution should reach to the beneficiary, to the person who required that, and that it should reach, if that person cannot afford, it should reach in a manner, in pro bono manner.
Okay, so but then, you know, even the NRC in Assam has excluded 19 lakh people.
So
yes, तो अब उनकी मदद कौन कर सकता है? क्या उनके पास कोई रास्ता है? क्योंकि गरीबी की वजह से often all the other routes are closed to people.
देखिए, अभी बहुत कंफ्यूजन है। फॉर आसाम द NRC रूल्स आर इन प्लेस। सुप्रीम कोर्ट हैज मॉनिटर्ड दिस होल एक्सरसाइज। दिस होल एक्सरसाइज हैज बीन ओनली बीन पॉसिबल बिकॉज ऑफ सुप्रीम कोर्ट। नाउ दोज हु हैव बीन एक्सक्लूडेड, दे हैव अ चांस टू गो फॉर एन अपील बिफोर द फॉरेनर ट्राइब्यूनल। हाउ फॉरेनर ट्राइब्यूनल्स फंक्शन इज अ सेपरेट स्टोरी इन इटसेल्फ। इट इज वेरी डिस्टर्बिंग. If I share the details, it's very disturbing, because even prior to this whole NRC exercise being completed and becoming a part of mainstream discussion, the exercise of exclusion through foreigners tribunal was continuing. And I, as an individual advocate, have been handling these matters since 2014.
So that means that when the NRC is now, there is talk of it being extended to the whole country.
And again in Assam. So those people for whom we were ready to file appeal, we got their documents, we prepared some format for appeal as per the Civil Procedure Code, because even the rules for appeal is not given, the format is not given anywhere. So we went according to the Civil Procedure Code, we prepared a draft format for appeal. We were in the process of preparing appeal for those who have sent their documents to us or have spoken to us, and those who are eligible for that legal aid. But recent statements that were made in the parliament or otherwise indicate that there will be a fresh NRC in whole of India, including Assam.
Right.
So we have put our Assam's operations on hold for now.
CAA hai, NRC hai, और NPR है, इन तीनों चीजों के बीच में क्या कनेक्शन है, ये जरा आप समझाइए।
पहली बात, गंगाधरी शक्तिमान है, एनआरसी ही एनपीआर है।
अच्छा।
और ये मैं नहीं कह रहा हूँ, मैं ये खुद नहीं कह रहा हूँ, मेरे पास ये है कि 26 नवंबर 2014 को इज अ पीआईबी स्टेटमेंट दैट सेज एनपीआर इज जस्ट द फर्स्ट स्टेप टुवर्ड्स एनआरसी।
पीआईबी का यानी कि प्रेस इंफॉर्मेशन ब्यूरो,
प्रेस इंफॉर्मेशन ब्यूरो ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ एमएचएफ। नाउ ऑन 21 अप्रैल 2015 in Lok Sabha, in response to an unstarred question, the response was NPR will be master database for NRC. On 9th October 2019, in a response to an activist, MHA sent a clarification stating that NRC will be a register of all citizens which will be created from NPR, and said that this exercise will be conducted in all of India, including all the UTs, except for the state of Assam. So we need to understand, in 2010-11, there was a census that was conducted. As per the information available on the website of MHA, apparently a sort of a token or receipt was given to people, a certificate of sort or small document. People were asked to keep that safely. No one remembers that they were given this slip. And as per the information available on this website, this token or this slip might play a very important role for NPR 2020.
Why would it be important?
Because if the rules are not modified and if what is on the website is correct, then you will have to present that receipt for you to be included in NPR.
Achha.
And but however, there has been statements made, there has been response that said that NPR will be conducted as a house-to-house enumeration exercise.
Right.
So if that happens, it will still be better, because I have spoken to quite a few people in UP, Delhi, etc. And no one seems to remember that they were given any receipt.
Okay, and what is this receipt supposed to prove? That aap census mein count hue hain?
That aap 2010 mein bhi yahan pe the, aap census mein count hue hain. आपने ये डिटेल्स दिए हैं, इस डिटेल के बियॉन्ड, लाइक अगर कोई मर गया है, कोई नया पैदा हो गया है, तो उसको मॉडिफाई करके एक फाइनल ड्राफ्ट तैयार करेंगे।
यानी कि एक तरह से लोगों के लिए रेट्रोस्पेक्टिवली हो रहा है, उनको एक कागज का टुकड़ा दिया गया जो उन्हें याद है कि नहीं है, रखा कि नहीं रखा पता नहीं, लेकिन वो सडनली अब बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट हो सकता है।
आपकी गलती है, क्योंकि कागज तो आपको 1987 से पहले के भी ढूंढने हैं, आपको रखने तो वो भी थे, वो लोगों ने वो भी नहीं रखे।
जी।
कुछ का कहना है कि अब्बा बकरा रखते तो बकरा कागज खा गया और अब्बा बकरा खा गए, तो आप वो कागज कहाँ से लेंगे? ये तो एक पतली सी स्लिप है, ये किसी के पास है किसी के पास नहीं है, मेरी फैमिली को नहीं याद है।
जी।
और हम बनारस में ना जाने कब से रह रहे।
तो अब एक बात बताए कि पूरे देश में प्रोटेस्ट चल रहे हैं, कहीं ना कहीं पे कोई ना कोई छोटी मोटी आग लग रही है इस इश्यू को लेकर, लोग परेशान हैं कि हम अब सिटीजनशिप रख पाएंगे अपनी या हमारी सिटीजनशिप हमारे हाथ से निकल जाएगी, तो इसमें लीगल उपाय क्या हो सकता है?
देखिए, लीगल उपाय ये है कि अपने कागज ठीक कीजिए, सबसे पहले सबसे जरूरी है। हम ICLU की तरफ से भी जगह जगह जाके, जहाँ जहाँ से भी हमें इन्वाइट्स आ रहे हैं, इन्वाइट्स नहीं आ रहे, जहाँ हमारे अपने लोकल रिसोर्सेज हैं लॉ यूनिवर्सिटीज़ में, बाकी जगह लॉ यूनिवर्सिटीज़ में, ख़ास करके हम इसलिए जाते हैं क्योंकि लॉ यूनिवर्सिटीज़ में एक लीगल एड कमेटी होती है जिसका काम होता है लोगों को लीगल एड एंड अवेयरनेस देना। माई प्लान, आवर प्लान इज दैट वी ट्रेन देम विद रिगार्ड टू NRC, एंड दीज स्टूडेंट्स कैन होल्ड डिफरेंट लीगल एड कैंप्स इन देयर एरियाज इन देयर स्टेट, एंड सो दैट दिस थिंग कैन हैव अ बेटर आउटरीच।
But we don't know that what documents we need.
As for now, the law is pretty clear on citizenship. Okay. Even if we leave CAA aside, there is Section 3 of Citizenship Act that determines your citizenship by birth. Section 3.1 says, 3.1A says, anyone born before 1st July of 1987 in India is an Indian citizen. After 1st July 1987 till 2004, anyone born in India will have to prove that he was born in India.
Right.
and also that either of his parent is an Indian citizen. That anyone who was born after 2004 will have to prove that either of his parent is an Indian citizen and the other is not an illegal immigrant. This is where CAA becomes very dangerous and unconstitutional. Because what CAA does, that by amending Section 2, it changes the definition of illegal immigrant.
Okay.
Now, those who came to India, those who are non-Muslims from Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Afghanistan, those who came before 31st December 2014, will not be considered to be an illegal immigrant. Effectively, putting those kids born after 2004, the Muslim kids at a disadvantage with non-Muslims kid. Because I have to, as a Muslim kid born after 2004, I will have to prove that my parent is not an Indian citizen, is not an illegal immigrant. Either of my parents is not an illegal immigrant.
Right.
That burden is not on a non-Muslim child born after 2004.
All right.
So this is how it becomes very unconstitutional under Article 15. And I have not even started on basic structure and Article 14.
Right. So you have also got a network of lawyers, other people who are helping you, or
have a team of lawyers, all under 30, okay. Prominently mostly female lawyers, okay. And we have a network in now almost every affected area of UP, affected by protest, police brutality, violence, and in Jharkhand, in Maharashtra, in Assam. We have a small, very small network in Punjab and other places as well.
What are you trying to do over there? What is the effort all about?
Now the effort has the focus. It was started with the focus on lynching to ensure the implementation of Supreme Court guideline in the lynching cases. Mm-hmm. But right now we have a twin focus. This NRC exercise will be unprecedented. Nowhere in the world an exercise of this magnitude has been conducted. In Assam alone, the NRC that they are saying that we will scrap, it caused a loss of 1400 crore to exchequer. And they want to scrap it. Assam is a small state. Think about a state like Uttar Pradesh. And think about the burden it is going to put on exchequer. So we want to be present everywhere there is a need, everywhere there is a person in distress and who can be provided any legal aid, whose fundamental rights, whose right under the law we can secure, and to strengthen the rule of law as much as we can.
So one of the issues that will, no doubt it will arise, is that when you go to a panchayat to seek your documentation, then there will be a refusal or a denial or a delay or a demand for certain kind of favors for giving these documents. Is it at this stage that you can actually help people?
Yes, because everywhere we go, we are mostly invited. So there is already a understanding that there are people who want to get their documents in order. And this is beyond a religion, caste, sect. Because everyone is scared, everyone is frightened. They may or may not show it. But every family is looking for documents. Every family is trying to find if there is any problem in the document, if there is a typographical error. Because the experience from Assam is now before everyone in India. And there is no reason why that fiasco, that issue will not be replicated again.
And can you explain again why it is that only the Muslims should not be worried? Why every citizen of India should be worried about NRC and CAA when both are combined?
As things stands now, and leaving alone the statements made by the leaders, only purely on the law, the line for the NRC, submission of the document for NRC will be secular, just like that was for demonetization. Okay. It will be completely secular. Everyone will have to get into that line.
Right.
Now this will effectively, and demonetization was still a small thing compared to this. This is the core. This is citizenship. No one wants to lose citizenship. Once you lose it, you cannot go anywhere as a migrant. You will have to go as a refugee. So, no one wants to take that risk. Everyone will have to present their documents. And an NRC list will be out. Those who will be left, as per law, as it is today. Those who will be left out of NRC, the Muslims will have to prove that they were Indian citizens born in India before 87 and otherwise. Right. A non-Muslim will have to either prove this, right, or will have to prove that they came from Bangladesh, mm-hmm, Pakistan and Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. Now, the question is, how do you prove that? Before a foreigner tribunal, where the burden of proof is on you, mm-hmm, where a small typographical error will get you out, what could be the document that you will present to prove that you are an Indian citizen, that you came from these countries? And the bigger question is, out of crores of non-Muslims, how many actually came from outside?
It would be very difficult for someone who lives in, say, Kerala or Tamil Nadu to claim that they came from Afghanistan.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly. Even in a UP, Haryana, other places. Like Punjab, I understand. Bengal, I understand. Right. Kashmir, I understand. Gujarat also, I may understand. What about other places? Mm-hmm. In the Hindi heartland, in Odisha or South India. How will you prove that you came from Afghanistan, Pakistan? So basically, effectively putting them also in danger.
Right. So, The fundamental question is that, you know, as a lawyer, do you see the NRC process, actually, does it make legal sense to have such an exercise?
Not at all. This is the most baseless exercise ever. For any legislative action to take place, there has to be some objective. There has to be some data backing it. There has to be some study backing the need for that. We don't have any. In Assam, at least there was some issue. It could be justified, even though I don't justify even NRC Assam. But it could still be justified.
It was taken as an exception in any case.
An exception in any case. For the rest of India, do you have any data how many illegal immigrants are in India? And if you have data, if you have identified them, then please throw them out. No one is standing for illegal immigrants here. Mm-hmm. But for, say, 10,000 illegal immigrants that there may be, you are putting citizenship of 2 billion Indians, you are threatening the citizenship of 2 billion Indians. So this makes no sense at all. And coupled with the stress that you are giving to the population, putting the population, a young population that you could use for so many things, you could use for something better, something to you know, as you claim to be a Vishwa Guru, you could have used for that. But instead, you are asking this whole lot to stand in the line and submit their document and be stressed about the objections, be stressed, and then if there is an objection, be called again and again, explain yourself, and then be stressed about the final result.
I want to draw your attention to one more provision, which is that anybody can raise an objection.
Yes. So in Assam, this happened. In Assam, on the eve of the closing of the objection, thousands of objections were filed by different organizations against people.
You mean people were protesting that so-and-so should not be on the list?
Yes, and this is xenophobia. This is complete xenophobia. It's one thing to let people submit their document and come out of it, mm-hmm, whether they're included in the NRC or not. It's the other thing that you go behind them with vengeance that, no, I will push you out. I will ensure that you're pushed out. And this will create such a fissure, because anyone on either of the spectrum can file the objection against anyone.
All right. So a huge chance of creating a lot of social unrest. Thank you for talking to us, Tanvir, about this important issue. Thank you very much for joining NewsClick.